Oh, hey guys. Welcome to the video on timing. This is going to wrap us up on the fifth of all of the artistic principles of real-time visual effects. There may be more principles of real-time visual effects art, but this is where I'm going to cut it off. So, timing. All right, so if shape is the most concrete, definable, you can make an alphabet out of it and everyone understands which shape tells you what, then timing, I think, is at the other end of the spectrum. It's the most abstract, it's the most sort of right-brained, hard to describe with words kind of principle, and it's tricky. There's a lot included here. This tutorial might be a little longer than the others because we're talking about timing and motion and how they both impact the art of visual effects, but we're gonna do our best anyway. Hard as it may be, let's go for it. All right, the League of Legends style guide. So here we have Sion doing an awesome ability. And, you know, this brought to mind some insight that I got from Adam Kugler. He's a lead class designer on World of Warcraft. He put it like this. There's like one critical thing to remember. And I would say if you only remember one thing from this video, just remember this, is that you want to lead the brain with anticipation, and then you want to overload the brain at the moment that it's been waiting for. And then you want to give the brain time to process what just happened. And this example here of Sion doing the build-up and then the big smash, and then there's like the fall-off and all that, is a pretty good example of that, right? Isaac Wood did a really great job of doing the build-up and the smash and the dissipation. So, if there's just one thing that you're trying to get your head around timing, like what should I do to have impactful, awesome timing? It's that awesome anticipation and buildup, the amazing overloading climax and payoff, and then time to process and have these nice outro elements that are oftentimes subtle and nice flavor that kind of give the effect an out. And we'll talk a little bit later about what happens when you don't have that, and how having that can really help. All right, so think of an effect as a sequence of beats, right? Beats, obviously, borrowed from the world of music. More on that later as well. You know, you've got this this tempo, and you've got, you know, the build-up, the pressure, and then the explosion, and then the nice dissipation. It's these nice beats, right? That's what we're talking about with timing. All right, so now we're transitioning briefly over to motion. Now, as a visual effects artist, you are a student of nature, right? It's your job to capture natural phenomenon and put it into art, right? Now, this is, oops, I hit a button. There we go. And they're still paused. Hang on, guys. 1 second. So it's your job to put it into the game or whatever it is that you're working on, right? Now, out of the box, a lot of particle editors are going to have built-in physics. They're going to have like built-in ways that things move and behave. And that's going to be a fine start. But you need to have a discerning eye to understand, oh, but I know in real life, I need to tweak this to get it to feel more accurate. Or, you know, like I see that it's kind of doing that motion like it would in real life, but man, if I added this nice little flourish over here, I saw that one time on this other YouTube video of like things exploding or whatever, like I like how it did that thing. And always studying reference and gathering how things work, understanding the laws of physics and nature is really critical. Because you are the one on the team that is the subject matter expert on all things that move that are not characters, right? And oftentimes, you know, depending on who's coming to you asking for something, that person, you know, they're going to see fire, maybe it's out of the box fire, and they're going to say, sure, it looks like fire. And it probably does look like fire out of the box with the default settings. But you should know better. You should know that if you really wanted to make that fire awesome, you got to know all the different levers that you want to change on it to make it move, believably to have good timing and all these other things. And so really studying fire and being a student of fire is going to help you in that situation to deliver something that is going to exceed expectations and blow people away. Now, obviously, some people are totally in a great spot to know exactly what they want from the element that they're asking from you. I'm not saying that, you know, effects artists are the only ones with this knowledge, but I will say that if you want to be the very best effects artist that you can be, referencing how things move is super critical. Okay, I belabored that point enough. Now we'll move on to the one that you got a sneak peek on before. Now, I'm going to go deeper into this example later on, and I actually approach it a little differently than Jin does. Jin has these graphs of like position over time. I wanted to clarify a little more on that, and so you're going to see these broken down slightly differently. Suffice it to say, you know, he's talking about punchy timing versus even timing, but I'll break that down more for you later. All right, so here we have timing as it relates to things lingering around on screen. And we kind of talked about this in the value section where there was the Lux missile. Remember, it was a fireball and had this really long trail behind it. And it wasn't clear if that whole trail was an area of effect or not. Well, this is very similar where it's like you want to reduce visual clutter. Now, this is the same ability, but just two different skins on Syndra. And one of them leaves an icy splotch on the ground, which, you know, it's cool, these ice. And then the other one just sort of has this like glowy cloud with like a nice bright spot in the middle that pops out pretty quickly and just goes back down to the fuzzy ball. Now, the difference here is important. This icy splotch, cool as it may look, is taking up gameplay space long after it has any impact on gameplay. So when it first hits, it does damage, right? And then it doesn't need to be there anymore. You can get rid of it, you can get it out of the gameplay space, and let it move along. Because the longer you leave it there, the longer it's drawing visual attention, and the longer it's going to cover up anything else that might come underneath it, heaven forbid. And it's also going to cause confusion, like, should I not step on it? Am I going to slip and fall because it's ice? I don't know. So the basic thought is here, like, suit your timing to match the gameplay implications, right? Timing is really valuable for matching gameplay. All right, so let's go on to the four principles of animation. I chopped out the other eight. You guys, I'm sure, have heard about the famous 12 principles of animation. I think all of them have some application to VFX, for sure, but really there's four that we want to get the meat out of. All right, so squash and stretch, and hopefully my frame rate is capturing this well enough for you to see and understand what's happening. So in all of these examples, in all four of them, the red is not demonstrating it, and the blue is demonstrating it. So the red is not stretched or squashed, and the blue is. Now, both of these, incidentally, are traveling at the exact same speed, and you know they have the exact same hit impact effect, but because the blue one is stretched, A, it feels faster, right? And B, it doesn't strobe. They're also at the same frame rate. But the red one looks actually like it's at a lower frame rate because it's round, and so the shapes don't blend together from frame to frame. This definitely goes into shape, and it overlaps hugely with shape. I'm aware of that. So just take it with a grain of salt. But it will help the feeling of your timing and your punchiness if you stretch your shapes into the way that they move. If that makes sense. And not have, like, choppy linear side-to-side motion. All right, anticipation. So I mentioned this earlier about, you know, building it up for the brain and then overloading the brain, right? Funny thing happens. With the red one, it's just kind of a pop, but the blue one, which has the exact same pop animation, feels more impactful, it feels punchier, feels more satisfying because it has that build-up beforehand. You don't always have time in a video game to do a build-up. Sometimes the effect needs to happen immediately. But oftentimes you do. And so anytime you have opportunity for a build-up, like, you know, between like the time the player uses an ability or an enemy uses an ability and then the enemy or the ability fires, use that opportunity to do a nice build-up. And oftentimes you can incorporate character animation here as well to really help sell that anticipation. something like winding up a sword or like, you know, raising an arm to shoot a gun or something like that to really build the anticipation. All right. Slow in and slow out. So, again, these two have the same lifetime. But because they're spaced differently on how quickly they're fading in and out, you can see that, you know, there's a significant difference in how they feel. And maybe this one is subtle, actually. Maybe it's not the most significant, but it's that nice little touch, that feeling of like, you know, it's not linear. Like, the blue one scales up quickly and then, like, slowly grows after that. The blue one also, like, you know, fades in quickly and then has this nice, like, outro where it's, like, fading subtly. Whereas the red one is just kind of, like, just kind of uniformly expanding like a balloon and doesn't have quite as much visual interest as the blue example. All right, secondary action. Now in these two, the trails are different because on the blue one, we have this nice little wobble of motion. There's this nice little fade out that they have. Whereas the red one, you know, it feels like a particle system. It's like spawn, you know, these little particles spawning in place. This is where you start getting into, you know, when you're in the particle editor, it's important that any emitter that you use, any group of particles that you're using, doesn't clearly show up as particles, if that makes sense. Like, you want it to feel like it naturally comes off, especially the secondary elements and the secondary action. You want it to accentuate the primary effect. Give it a nice little flourish, nice little swirl, whatever it is. But make sure those particles marry with the effect and give it a nice follow-through and secondary action. Cool. So those are the four principles of animation. And moving along. Okay, this is where it gets interesting. So when you're editing effects, those of you who are effects artists are familiar with this kind of graph where you've got X, Y, and Z. Representing how the particle card or mesh or whatever it is moving through space, right? So it's like, cool. So the timing of how it moves, we can talk about timing using X, Y, and Z, except don't forget, we also have to talk about velocity, and that's only one line, but actually you have velocity on X, Y, and Z, right? Oh, and scale. You gotta figure out how it scales over time, you know, on X, Y, and Z. And the color, red, green, and blue. Don't forget that, how that animates over time. And the rotational velocity, and the transparency, and then any other feature that you can imagine. And very quickly, you start to understand that it gets confusing. This is the blessing and the curse of visual effects, is that you can do anything with your particle editor. And that's great, because it gives you a lot of power, but it makes it very challenging to talk about something as abstract as like timing when you have to think about animating all of these timings over time, the color, transparency, the position, etc. So to simplify it, and this might be an oversimplification, I'm well aware, we're just going to talk about intensity over time. Now, what do I mean by intensity? Well, basically, what we're looking at is how eye-grabbing is it at that moment? So in this example, it would not at all be eye-grabbing at the beginning of its lifetime, but by the end of it, it would be like, whoa, I cannot look away. It's maximum intensity. And you can accomplish that in many ways, right? Like intensity can be, you know, rapid motion of like a material, like, you know, just frantically like scrolling or dissolving or doing whatever it does. It can be just how bright it is. It can be like, is it flickering? Bright and dark. It can be, I don't know, is it spinning? Is it just big on the screen at that moment? And so that hopefully simplifies it down a little bit. We'll give a couple examples as well. We've got a missile, which, you know, it's pretty eye-grabbing as it travels along, you know, and then maybe when it hits, maybe I should put it like a spike here because it like would spike up when it impacts and explodes, right? An explosion. There you go. Starts really intense, just boom. And note that this isn't size, right? Like explosions start small and then get big, but the intensity of an explosion starts big because from the very first moment that explosion is alive, yes, it's small, but it's rapidly, rapidly expanding. And I would say because it's rapidly getting bigger, that means that during that point in time, it is very intense. And then it's also like rapidly decelerating, right? Like we know explosions, they come out, they hit the air around them, which the air pressure pushes back on the explosion, creates these interesting rolling motions in it, and it very, very quickly slows down, right? So the intensity, therefore, ramps down pretty quickly from that first moment that it blows up. A blinking light. Oops, sorry if I bumped the microphone there. A blinking light. So, you know, this doesn't have to be a blinking light. This could be like a, I don't know, like a short circuit, like electric bolt. This is, bzz, bzz, you know, like flaring on beats. You know, I mentioned beats before. Having beats in your effects is really valuable where, you know, this looks like an EKG, right? Where it's like spiking up and then going down and spiking up and going down. It creates really nice visual interest and visual contrast when your timing is varied, when your intensity is varied, right? And a portal. Portal's going to be a little more subtle. Maybe it has like a shimmer where it like pulses bright and then fades out and then pulses bright and then fades out and kind of like has this, you know, sine wave kind of pattern of intensity. All right, so none of this, just the four principles of animation and intensity over time. Excuse me. All right, so here we have a fun example. This is Reaper Soraka, and both of these are Shadow Isles themed. Right, or undead themed. Now, the example on the left is Reaper Soraka actually getting hit by another character named Karthus who's casting his ultimate on her. And the one on the right is Reaper Soraka casting her own ultimate on herself to heal herself. So here we have a holy healing thing that needs to mix with undeath on the right. And then we just have pure, like, damagey evil impending doom on the left. Did I say the left or the right? The first one. Happy's healing on the right, damaging on the left. Okay, so anyway, when we look at the intensity over life, we have something like this. Now you remember talking about, you know, building up the anticipation and then that amazing overload of the brain and then you have this nice fall off right here. This fall off at the end is really important. You'll notice like after it hits, has this nice little dissipation. It doesn't last as long as the buildup did, but it gives you this nice satisfaction of like, oh yeah, she got hit. That, I really, really nailed it, right? Which this ultimate requires no skill to hit, but you nailed it. Good job. Whereas over here on the right, the healing is instant. So the moment you press the button, you know, it's maximum intensity, the heal has happened, and then quickly falls off and then has these like long dissipation with like these sparkles just kind of like hanging around, chilling out for a while. Now you'll notice that the shapes and the colors, except for the red here, are largely the same. It's like it's all ghouly. There's even ghouly faces here and in here. And so we had to differentiate by timing. That's really the only option you have. And so by doing this difference in timing, we can make them feel like different abilities. Even more than that, the follow-through of the sparkles helps it feel nice and friendly, and that's about, you know, there's timing, but there's also motion. Like they move in a very fluid sort of way with a nice like orbit to them, right? So they have this nice random ethereal kind of vibe to them. So that's how you can differentiate if everything else is the same. All right, so you remember before I promised you that we'd come back to the echo example. So we're going to look at a few examples here. We're going to look at the timing kind of coming up and down. And then we're going to look at that compressed to come up and down quickly. And then we're going to look at it with this sharp point and see what difference that gets us. So here we have it coming up and down, kind of like floats upward and then floats downward, right? And you look at this, colors are great, shapes are great, the values are great, and oftentimes you'll show this to an art director, or, you know, it happens to all of us. Like, I'm not trying to pick on art directors. Timing is freaking hard. You'll show it to somebody and they'll be like, feels nice. If they're not well-versed in timing, that's the caveat. Like, if you can find somebody who really knows their stuff with timing, highly recommend you run it by them. Because I'll tell you right now, this could use some improvement. So the temptation is to speed it up, make it punchier, right? Ain't gonna happen. Really what it needs is it needs that slow buildup and then a huge spike of intensity and then a nice subtle fall off. Notice also that it has variation in timing on these bits all around. So back to this example again. You know, like I said, like this kind of thing slips by me all the time. You really have to be vigilant to understand when your timing is and is not working, because it's so common to overlook this. Always ask yourself, did I push it really hard with the timing? And the other problem is too, timing usually comes later, right? It comes after you've built your shapes, after you've balanced your colors and your values and the ability has been defined. Now, because it comes after all of that, you might have a little bit of fatigue working on the effect and you might be kind of done with it. I'm saying you, but this is exactly what happens to me all the time. So the key is to not get lazy and just say, well, screw it. I'm just going to make it poppier, because then, you know, this doesn't have the buildup and it doesn't have the payoff at the end. It kind of has a nice spike of intensity in the middle, but it's just not rewarding. It's not giving the brain that delightful brain candy that it's after when it wants delicious timing. Delicious candy. So, yeah, always ask yourself, like, can I push the timing harder? Can I really see how far it can go to feel nice and satisfying, with a nice punch to it? So that's those examples. And that'll wrap it up, I guess. So remember to hit up the forum. I'm not going to be back for a while, probably, with more tutorials, but I am available on the forum over at realtimevfx.com. You can go and hit me up over there, hit up all the awesome talent that you see on there. Really great guys and gals in the industry working on this stuff. Attached to the forum is a job board that I manage. And if you're looking for a job in the industry, if you're looking to fill a job in the industry with a real-time VFX artist, recommend checking it out. And there you have it. You can hit me up at Kaiserito. I'm over on Twitter and I'm on the forum, of course. And then my website, if you want to find out any other stuff that I've posted or created over the years. So that's it, guys. I've really enjoyed doing this series for you. I hope you get a lot out of it. And most of all, I hope you keep making awesome.